Hi guys, welcome to the Talk Around Town show. I'm calling on Mass and your entertainment host, and with me today, as always, is the lovely Courtney Bailey, love that necklace,
Thank you.
The brilliant Dan Weeks. What's up, brother?
I'm wearing my Mandalay Bay lotion from Vegas that I got, hand lotion.
Hand lotion?
Smells like Vegas.
Which means it smells like bad decisions and debauchery and broken dreams, right?
But I was there for work, so yeah. Thank you for joining us this week, guys. We actually have a lot planned. We have House Representative Mark Cardenas from the state of Arizona here. So he'll be coming on after the break.
Nice.
Really cool. And so I'm looking forward to that one. We also have...
A local director, actually an international director, here on the show today. He's a personal friend of mine, and he's just a great guy, so I can't wait to delve into some of his work with him, too.
And we can't wait to meet him.
Yay! And I heard you had some good news, that you landed some epic gig or something like that.
Yeah, I got a client yesterday.
Nice.
New client.
Not that it's her only one. She has multiple clients, but she got a new client.
Yeah.
But
this one's good. That's always good.
This one's two houses.
Yeah.
So their new house and then redoing the old house so they can sell it.
Oh. Ooh.
Pretty excited.
She has a good eye. Of course, some people think she has too. But seriously, no. I mean, I've seen some of your work, so I know you're really good at what you do. Yeah, indeed. Actually, if you guys watch, I think it's one of the first episodes of the show.
There's a spot of her, I think,
like time-lapse photography, and she's all, like, it'd be great if you would have added, like, some Benny Hill music to it.
That would have been good. I couldn't have taken that as seriously, though. But or just go to her website, which is, why don't you tell us, chicinteriorsbydesign.com. Chicinteriorsbydesign.com.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all on there. But I'm going to delve right into the tech segment today since we have a very full show.
Yeah, go for it.
No notes. Are you proud of me? I'm not using notes today. This
You're
is all from memory.
I'll never not have my tablet. Ever. I need it. It's a part of me.
Well, I know. I usually need notes, except nothing too technical today. But Google Glass is no longer part of the Google Experiment Lab. It is now its own standalone product. So Google Glass is projected to hit shelves later this year.
Wow.
Oh, okay. So
finally.
Explain to me what the Google, I mean, I've heard of it and whatnot, but I'm not a techie person. So what is
Google Labs, like Google X it's called, is basically, it's like the Google development. So, I have a suspicion that it's, say the Google self-driving car we talked about a couple weeks ago crashes, right? Because it's not working. But then they can say, oh, it's our experimental lab. It's not our fault. That kind of thing. So I think that's what it is. So the Google Glass has proven to not be, first of all, it's not a two-ton
a crazy
car driving
robot
itself.
On
yeah.
your face.
But so it's proven to work from what I understand. They still have to work out a couple bugs, I think. But it's looking like it's going to come out later this year. So wow. Google has taken it from experimental to mainstream, essentially. That's all it is.
So what is it?
Yeah.
Is what I'm trying to figure
what
out.
What is Google Glass?
Yeah, what is it like just like glass on a table?
Oh,
Google
I thought you meant, I'm sorry, I thought you meant what their lab was.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out what is
Google
it?
Glass is this really cool, okay, so it's like glasses, and it's kind of like glasses you wear, but not really, but there's this little prism cube, is it your right or left eye? It's one of your eyes, it goes in front of one of your eyes, and it's this little prism cube. So it connects with your smartphone, it connects with
And you
with
can everything. See stuff through it.
Yeah, but nobody else can see it. So there was a lot of...
what if you can only see through one eye? You can't walk around
then
with
I'm sure
one
they,
eye
I'm
covered.
Sure they
so
would
they can
custom
see.
Fit it.
Custom fit it to that eye.
There's
well,
rare
yeah,
glasses
but,
up
I mean,
this doesn't work. That's because you're blind in your right eye.
But I mean, you cover one eye and you're walking around and you can't see with one eye because you got all this stuff going on.
No. It's not. It doesn't cover it. You know what the HUD displays are like in BMW?
Like in that car.
Yeah. In the car that we had a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
The numbers appear on the dash. It's like a reflection type thing. So this prism basically
Yeah, but you'll still have all this stuff in front of your eye.
Well, yeah, but you can see past it.
Google photos of tiger heads.
You ready? You ready?
And you keep joking about Terminator, but I think Google's like on top of this.
Because honestly,
car.
If you remember Terminator, like the stuff just scrolled up his eyes in front of his eyes.
Well, that's exactly
he
what it is.
He still saw everything.
And you can say Google.
The robots are taking over.
But you can say something, I think it was like Google, take a picture, and Google, or Glass, take a picture, and it'll actually take a picture of what you're looking at. So there's this cool thing where they're jumping out of planes and in a hot air balloon and taking pictures, and so there's that, it can record video.
Oh,
basically what I have for the tech segment. Just some food for thought there.
That's cool, though. I'll have to look into that more. I mean, that's pretty freaking awesome.
And I don't know the price point yet, because I tried getting a developer kit, but unfortunately, they only gave out a couple thousand of them. And I was like, oh, it's late.
It's going to be ridiculously expensive.
Yeah.
For the first couple years, just like everything is ridiculously expensive.
Because everybody's going to want it.
And then, you know, I mean, and they can charge whatever they want. I mean, it's a great new tech. They can charge whatever they want.
Yeah.
But once it becomes more mainstream.
Well, it was a couple $100 for the dev kit. And one of my friends, I was so mad at myself because he called me and he's like, hey, you should definitely apply for this. This is like step back 2 years, and we're talking about looking at the developer kit then. So, like 2 years ago, he said, hey, why don't you...
Like, that's not a thing. I'm not.
Yeah, he's like,
that.
Go online, apply for this. There's a couple hundred left. And I was like, oh, no, it's not going to take off, whatever. So then I go on the next day, and of course, at that time, they're out, but he got one. So I've seen it in person, but it's just, it looks really funny on people's faces. But it's going to be, it's like, you know, cell phones, like the smartphones. Nobody was used to seeing
those. They'll
be
really big, and then they're going to get small.
Another big,
it's going to change. But anyway, I know a lot of our viewers, you guys are probably wanting to see Mark and not hear more about the Google Glass. So rather than talk about Glass, let's cut to commercial. When we come back, we have Mark Cardenas with us.
Hi guys, this is Colleon Maston here at Best Buy for the Talk Around Town Show. And I'm here with Paul and Michaela St. John. And we are in the Disney Infinity section. Disney Infinity is a fantastic game that Disney has invented. So guys, do you see any characters that you guys like a lot? There's Hulk right there. Tinkerbell, I love Tinkerbell. So your favorite character is the Hulk? Good stuff, go ahead and grab him. Nice, turn it around so the camera can see. The other way, so we can see there you go. Say, this is the Incredible Hulk.
This is the Incredible Hulk.
And he smashes things.
And he smashes things.
But he's also a gentle giant.
And also he's a gentle giant.
Fantastic, I love it.
This is Tinkerbell.
And what does she do?
She flies around Tinkerbell City.
What would you do if you had fairy dust?
I would put it all over me so I can fly around the Tinkerbell City.
Come on down to Best Buy or check out BestBuy.com. If your kids are into Disney Infinity or any number of other video games or entertainment systems, everything you want is here at Best Buy. Remember, turn on your life with Best Buy.
Welcome back to the Talk Around Town Show. Joining me today is my friend Mark Cardenas. And Mark, you are a House representative.
Yes, I have been for 2 years, and I've just got elected to serve another 2 years. So.
And that's awesome. So you're 28 years old. How did you get to the position you're in? Because you were in the Army, and then when most people get out of the Army, they don't become House Representative or join government. So how are you in this position now?
Well, I was a government employee before, so it just seemed as if it was a natural step. So I actually started by when I was still in the military. I started volunteering on different campaigns for people that I liked, and so I felt that if they got elected, it was as if I was able to vote because they had this kind of the same mindset I did. So I did have to ask for special permission to work on campaigns, because you can't do it in the military unless you get permission. So it just grew from there, and when I finished school, I decided the seat was open, so I decided then the time was now to run for office.
With your time in the military, I'm assuming you saw a lot and experienced a lot, and that's really kind of made you who you are as a representative. How does your military experience affect you differently than other representatives who haven't had the same background?
I would say having military experiences allows you to be seen as more of more knowledgeable on veterans issues. Mm-hmm. Yesterday, I don't know if you know, but the proposal by the governor was to sweep some funds from a military relief fund in order to run veteran cemeteries. Mm-hmm. Military relief fund is to fund different things, as if a wife needs to go visit her husband who's injured at Walter Reed in D.C. or needs to, you know, they need to retrofit their house so if they're disabled, they can bring a wheelchair in there. So it's an incredibly important fund. So I guess the original proposal is we can sweep it. It'll be used for cemeteries. We're all helping veterans, but at the same time, you know, to having that experience as a veteran, knowing that there's people that I've served with, you know, being able to help individual families is incredibly important. So we were able to stop that cut. So just being able to say, you know, this is based on my experience, this is why it's a bad idea, and people listened. So
right.
It's a very, very different aspect, a very different reception than if anyone else would have done that.
Yeah, and then you had mentioned individual families, and you like helping individuals. So tell me about the time when you pretended to be homeless for a week.
Pretended. Oh, it was horrible. So I was homeless for a total of 4 days. So the idea behind that is that we knew that there was a women's transitional living facility that was due to close. They had lost their federal grant.
Mm-hmm.
And so they needed roughly about $55,000 in order to stay open for the time being until they applied and were accepted for another one. So we decided, you know, I could have sent a letter to the governor asking her to, you know, pay for it. I could have, you know,
right,
you know, emailed people who donate to my campaign and say, can you donate to this? But, you know, it was time to say, you know what, it was time to either put up or shut up, you know.
Yeah.
It was, you know, this is what's going to happen to them if you close the facility. So I'm willing to put myself on the line in order to keep it open. So we were able to actually raise a substantial amount of money in order to keep it open in the meantime.
And that's something I've never heard of anybody else in a position of either, you know, House representative or senator, anybody pretending to be homeless for a week and actually living on the streets, or 4 days even. So what did you learn throughout that time? What were some of the things that you saw?
So the first night we were there, we stayed in a parking lot across from the Cass homeless shelter.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't want to stay in a bed because we were taking a bed from someone that actually needs it.
Right.
But the overflow lot is they don't have enough beds for the people. They stay in a parking lot where they're generally safe for the mm-hmm. night. But the entire night, there was people that were mentally ill there that were yelling. There was people throwing cups of water at each other, getting into fights, doing drugs there.
Mm-hmm.
And then at 5 a.m., at 5 a.m., there was a whole group of people that got up, got dressed, and went to work. So it was it was incredible because I got no sleep that entire night just because of the commotion that was going on. And these people deal with the same thing, but they still have to put in 8 hours. And so how are you able to get off the streets? How are you able to function when you can't even sleep every day?
Right.
It was an interesting experience where you think that, you know, everyone that's homeless, they're going to just hang around the cast and wait until it opens back up. No, these people put on their hard hats mm-hmm. and went to work. It was so wow. The biggest thing that I learned is that, you know, we have a lot of working poor in this city.
Where do you see yourself going in the future, obviously to help more people like this, and just in general, what do you see yourself doing after this term?
After this term, I think it's always a decision whether you want to run for another one. Mm-hmm. This, you know, doing one term has horribly aged me already. But I enjoy what I do.
Yeah.
You know, how often do you get the opportunity to walk up to someone's house and say, you know, what can I do for you today? And someone says, well, the most interesting one was someone said, well, I've been calling this city. I need my street lights fixed. My kids can't play at night. It's dangerous. They can't ride their bikes. And so I said, let me take care of it.
Mm-hmm.
Called the city. They're out in 3 days. They fixed the light. And so that's how you realize that, you know, you're there because you're there to show your constituents that government can deliver.
Right. And before we wrap up on that note, so I'm friends with Mark on Facebook, and there's a story that I saw about a wasp's nest when you were going around getting petitions. So, you want to tell me about that?
Yeah. So, getting petitions, knocking on doors, I remember she didn't open her door. She left the screen door closed.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, well, I can't sign your petition. And why not? I mean, we had a great conversation. And she points up. Mm-hmm. I look up, and there's a small wasp nest above her door. So, I'm like, you know what? There's sticks outside. So, I went and hit it really hard, ran away. And hopefully the wasps were gone. And so I came back in a few minutes, and you know, it was gone. And she signed the petition, and it worked out. So
wow. And now here you are again, back in office. So
yeah.
Worked out perfectly.
Yeah.
So to our younger viewers who are going through some hardships in life, and a lot of, anybody really going through hardships in life, what advice would you have for them?
I would say the advice that you would have for someone is that if you're going through a hardship, you know, it's not, you know, there's people out there that can help. There's people out there that can care. If there's anything that something that you used to always tell your soldiers is that, you know, it doesn't matter if you wake up at 2 a.m. and you don't know where you're at,
mm-hmm.
call me and I'll come pick you up.
Right.
And it's the same thing as if we, you know, we do it now. If there's ever an issue, you know, my cell phone number is on my business cards. Everyone knows how to reach me. Mm. And I will, and I gladly help because that's my job.
Great. Well, Mark, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, Dan.
We really appreciate having you guys. Stick around, and when we come back, we'll have a lot more for you.
Hi, everybody. This is Colleen Mastin with the Talk Around Town show here at Best Buy. And once again, I'm here with Paul and Michaela. Say hi, guys.
Hi.
We're here in front of one of the many television displays right now. These are the LG 4K Ultra HDs. These things are awesome. You can see the facial hairs on people. They're fantastic. I watch all sorts of things on my TV. I watch a lot of Netflix and a lot of cartoons. One of my favorite things to watch is Avengers Assemble. How about you guys? You guys have a couple of movies that you guys like to watch. What is it that you like to watch?
I like Frozen.
And what's one thing that Little Einstein says all the time?
We have a mission.
We have a mission. And what's one thing that you got from Frozen that they say in Frozen a lot?
Let it go.
So guys, come on out to Best Buy, where you can find all of your entertainment material. You can get every TV you're looking for, DVD players, CD players, Blu-ray players, DVDs, all of it is right here at Best Buy. And remember, ready guys? Turn on your life with Best Buy.
Hi guys, welcome back to the Talk Around Town show. For this week's entertainment segment, I have a wonderful international director and a personal friend. At least I think he's a personal friend. Jabez, yes, how are you today, sir?
Fine, thank you. How are you?
Good. Good to see you. Welcome to the show, man.
Thanks for having me.
I know that you know you've got a long history in you know entertainment and broadcasting and what have you. Tell us a little bit about how you got started in directing films.
Ah, it's interesting. They say to every cloud there's a silver lining.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, when I was still back home in Zambia, I worked for the TV station and radio. And I was so much into drama. But then things didn't turn around until when I lost my son. I was so depressed after I lost my son. He died 3 years, 4 months. And I wanted just to tell a story about how much I loved him, how much mm-hmm. I cared for him. And I decided to come to the US to come and study film. So eventually, once I do my studies, once I make one or two movies, I'm now comfortable. I can make basically a movie about how much I love them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I came to the US. And of all the things, I came to Mesa Community College. I didn't go to Hollywood, but I came to Mesa
Community College.
Yes. And then I wrote my first script, which was an adaptation from an old story. And that's what everything changed in my life, because my producer took the script to Sundance. You know, normally there's a Sundance house in August
mm-hmm.
where they accept scripts from like amateurs, upcoming filmmakers. And I think that year they had about 900 scripts. They picked 100 and mine was one of them.
That's brilliant.
So that basically gave me the impression that, you know what, I think I can do it. And from there onwards, I've been on the journey.
Well, I mean, and the loss of a child, I mean, is, I couldn't imagine how that would feel, but to take that and to use that to propel yourself, to tell yourself, I'm going to America and I'm gonna go make movies, you know, but to leave everything you know behind and then to go halfway around the world to go somewhere and to go to school and then to write your first script and to have Sundance say, this is in the top 100 scripts that we've received. That's tremendous.
Yeah, I'm humbled. There are a lot of people that handle loss differently.
Yeah.
And I think it gave me just this feeling that I can do better. I think one of the things that has helped me is I always look at kids. I lost mine, but there are several hundred kids that may not have the attention that I wish I'd given my child.
Yeah.
And I always want basically just to tell what it means to be a parent, what it means to lose a child. So that has been my drive. And somehow it has taken me to places, that's brought me here.
You didn't expect.
And yeah, I think I'm on the right track.
That's fantastic. So, well, obviously, I know he's working on a new project. I'm in it. But, and this may seem oddly self-serving, but what is the, tell us about the project that, that you're working on right now. It's called?
Fathers and Daughters.
Fathers and Daughters, okay.
Yeah, so what happened after the script at Sundance, and then we went to Africa to shoot the film, and then we came back. It had some legal issues, and I decided, you know what? Let me try to do something on my own and see what I can do. Mm-hmm. So I wrote, I think, about 3 or 4 scripts, and this is probably like the first one I'm trying to do much more professional. Mm-hmm. It's called Fathers and Daughters. It's a combination of an odd African culture and basically the life of a Christian.
Okay.
It's in a nutshell, it's about an upcoming lawyer, very, very promising lawyer with a very promising career, who has been promised that he'd make a partner. But at the same time, he has a situation in his life involving his family. He's married, happily married, with one child. So now he has to choose between solving the problem at home or keeping his job. But every time he makes one move, it basically affects the other side. And he's trying to juggle two things. They say you can't have a cake and you can't eat the cake and keep at the same time. Mm. But he's trying to do both. He's trying to have the cake and kick and eat at the same
time. He's trying to balance everything.
So every move he makes, something goes wrong. So that's the story. It's an odd culture about the respect that men had, that you are respected if you have a child. And that's basically the story. At the same time, it's in the modern world about forgiveness, about respect for women. It's very, very difficult for people to forgive these days.
Yeah, I agree. And being in it, when I first read the script, I play the lawyer, by the way.
Good lawyer for that, man. Very good lawyer.
But when I first read the script, it grabbed me because there were a lot of twists and turns in it, and it was kind of like a chess game. You know, going on through the script, like you said, make one move and then something else happens to counter that move. It's like, goodness gracious, when is this guy going to catch a break? You know, so I think I think it's fantastic.
It's basically telling people that in a happy home, you support each other.
You support each other.
You pray for each other and you are there to just do everything for a friend.
Honestly, I know we're doing a lot of good work on this project, so...
I've been lucky to work with very good actors, very, very good actors.
Good cast.
And I'm so happy. They've just given me so much motivation.
So inspired me. How can people find out more about the film?
We have a website, but we haven't been loading information on the website. Very intentionally.
Intentionally, okay.
Very, very intentionally. We wanted to, you know, when you're doing a low-budget film, you are financing everything from your pocket. Sometimes you have difficulties, and I wanted to make sure that I've got 90% of the footage shot
before you start releasing.
I can tell people that I've got this. I didn't want to get stuck halfway. I get broke, and then I can't finish the film. So now we've got 80% of the film shot, and we will soon have 90%. And immediately we're there, the website goes up.
Right, and so what will the website be? So that way time comes.
It's actually www.zedianpictures.com.
Zedian?
Yes, zedianpictures.com.
Okay. Fantastic. Well, Jabez, thank you so much for coming out and speaking with us and hanging out with us and all the rest of that. I know it's a bit of a drive for you. Guys, we'll be right back.
Next time you're on the internet, which is probably right now on your smartphone, you should take a look at our website at www.thetalkaroundtownshow.com. Once you're on our website, feel free to click the Get Involved tab and apply to become a guest on our show or become a sponsor. Also, while you're there, click on our Facebook page and give us a like.
Hi guys, welcome back to the Talk Around Town Show.
Those are pretty good interviews.
That was great.
Yeah.
I mean, mine, of course, was good because I was in it.
Because
yours was pretty good, too. Yeah.
And I swear, the idea was not to be as self-serving as it turned out to seem like it was.
No, I mean, I thought it was great. You know, hearing Jabez's story was great because you've been talking about it because that's what you've been growing the beard for.
Yeah, I hate facial hair.
But I mean, that's actor dedication right there.
It's one of those things. Pain in the neck.
You couldn't have done like fake hair?
No, because it just makes no sense. Then I have to apply it every day, and you could be in the middle of filming and it starts hanging in the corner, and you have to reapply the spirit gum and
true
all that mess. It's annoying.
Oh, I know.
It's annoying.
There was Did he tell you? Did he ever tell you about when they had him laying on the cold ground at?
Oh God! I'll share those pictures with our
members
Facebook
club.
Page, on our
members Let's club. Do a members club and Facebook page.
Yeah. Yeah.
But so we were at lunch one time, and Callian was telling me about why he was tired from the night before, and so you were in a full green suit, right?
Full green suit.
With nothing underneath.
Nothing
and it was
underneath.
Just super
just,
thin. And this is like right when Phoenix was having its cold spell. But I mean, it was still like 35-ish degrees.
Oh, it was that. But I was also up on top of South Mountain.
On the cold rocks.
At like 10 o'clock at night. And then they were dumping fake blood and everything all over me in this tarry, goopy mess. And I'm just like, can you get the shot?
And it was like 2 hours.
Can we get the shot, please? It was like, I was on the ground for like an hour and a half. Please, can we get the shot?
And it's funny because then somebody I know worked the set, I think, or something, or maybe you got tagged in pictures, but I saw pictures from the set the next day, and I'm looking at it, and I was like, wow, nobody is actually, they're just taking their time. Nobody's rushing.
I was so cold. So. And like, there are times, and I try to be a very personable and nice person, because that really is who I am.
Yeah.
But I found myself, guys, just testing your patience. Get the shot, please! Get the shot! And like, you know, so when it comes out and people see my scene or whatever, when I'm reaching out and I'm the dead guy.
And you're shaking.
Because you're cold.
I'm shaking. It's not because I'm cold. I'm freezing. But that's the job as an actor. And the other actors on set were like, bro, you are dedicated. Man, I wish I could do that. I ain't doing it. But you are dedicated, brother. And my mother used to always say, neither job, great or small, do it well or not at all. Either be hungry and be the hardest person in the room, working person in the room, or don't do it.
Yeah.
Because we're not here to half step. Even, you know, with this show, I mean, we've come a long way.
Yeah.
Since we started this. A long way, so. Ooh! I'm going to share this on my Facebook page. But
is this what you were doing over break?
Yes, but there was like the video of this girl who was driving a car with her feet.
Feet girl.
Eating with her feet. Doing her eyeliner, which takes...
Like, you can't even tell the difference. I can't even do it, like, with my hands.
I can't even get my foot up to my face to do that.
Yeah.
Can you?
No.
You're tiny. Can you do it?
I don't know. I've never tried it.
You've never tried it. We need you to try it. No? Like, we'll do a special segment or whatever.
That'd be too weird.
But you were talking about a friend of yours.
Yeah, we were talking about really special, amazing people. So, my friend Corwin... who I actually, way back in college, I had a class with him. And guess what class? Any guesses? It was recording engineering.
Okay.
So we basically, the class was you record bands and you record singers and vocalists and just really you're working a recording studio. Mm. Mm. And so Corwin's blind. And I had volunteered to take notes for him, just kind of to help him out. So I took notes, but I didn't even need to because he was, like, surpassing me in recording, and this is what I do for a living, you know. And he's blind. And, I mean, he was riding the faders, and he was doing everything, controlling input, and it was really cool. And so, but one of my favorite stories from that class is we're in class, and there were some days where it was kind of boring because, you know, there's people like us who have done it before and who have actually worked studios, but then... There's the intro kids who just signed up and and barely know how to use their phone. So during those classes, for us it was kind of boring. It was still very informative, but all of a sudden I would get a text and I would like try to check my phone, you know, kind of under the table or slide, like do one of those things.
Just more obvious than just holding it up.
Yeah.
Or the phone prayer. But so I was trying to do that because like I didn't want to be rude and I was like, who is texting me during class? And then all of a sudden I would see Corwin texted me, right? And Corwin's like, he's like, hey, this class is really boring. And I would look over and I was like, how are you texting me? So he'd wear these dark glasses and he always had this earbud in. And I assumed he was listening to music or something. And then he had his iPhone and he would always hold it. So, no, apparently the iPhone screen just doesn't turn on because there's no point because he can't see it. But Corwin's so awesome because he sits there and he like moves his finger and you don't know what he's doing. And then all of a sudden I get a text message. So he's texting me during class. And it reads it back to him. And so when I texted him, I was like, why are you texting? How are you doing this right now? And he goes, because I'm bored, do you want to go hang out and ditch class or something? And so it was just really funny. So I'm trying to get him on the show. And you know what? My phone just vibrated. Oh, no, that wasn't him. How funny would that be if that were him? But
That's crazy.
Yeah, and so Corwin's in a band. He tours and he plays in his gospel band and does all this stuff.
That's so inspirational. Like,
yeah.
If you're one of those people who's like, oh, I can't because my foot, I can't do it because stop talking.
Yeah.
Think about Corwin and think about the girl who drives with her feet.
And the guy that Mark was talking about, you know, they can't sleep at night, the homeless people, and then they put on suits and go to work.
And go to work.
Hard hats. I mean, it's incredible.
It's like, come on. The capability of the human mind is so phenomenal. Get up, get out, get something.
Outcast. I set like 10 alarms at 15-minute intervals because I always snooze them.
Oh. I do the same thing.
I know.
I think everyone does.
Courtney's like, I don't. Those people annoy me.
Oh, you just hop right up, huh?
Yeah.
You're just fresh as a daisy. Woke up like this.
Sadly.
Sadly, it's all perfection. It's terrible.
No, but you know what? My hair, if I shower the night before and I do my hair, like, I just don't put any gel or anything in it, I wake up and it's just like that. Like, it's a little matted and I have to
fix it. A little matted.
I'm
like this, you know, and people complain about bedhead. And I'm like, you know what? People pay $300-$500 to go into some salons and have their hair look like, made to look like they just woke up.
Yeah.
And it's called bedhead.
Yeah.
Just roll around in your bed for a bit and then just sprinkle some mousse in your hair, spray some gel on.
My bed head isn't very attractive, though.
That's okay. You make it attractive.
Well,
it's all about your attitude. It's all about how you wear it. Is that a garbage bag? Yeah, it is. Derelict. Zoolander. Boom.
And I don't get fashion. I'll be the first person to say it. I don't understand, like, all the eccentric stuff that happens. Like, you know.
Last month. I just bought it a week ago. Throw it away. It was $500. Don't wear it. People will laugh at you. Why?
Well, okay, so like the shoot we did, and I'm sorry, what was your friend's name again?
Yakima Yarbrough.
I can never say Yakima Yarbrough.
His opinion designs.
He's good.
Yeah.
But I was looking at some of the stuff he brought with him, and I was like, I don't understand how that matches. Like,
what is this crushed red velvet blazer with this gray shirt or whatever? But it looks great once you put it together. It's like,
I would never think of it.
I've never thought about that.
Well, and like, I see some of the stuff that she does for clients, and it blows my mind. Never in a million years could I have done that.
Who decided to put that with that? No, it's all about the, because it's about fabrics and, you know, you don't want to wear all corduroy.
Well, get this. Yeah. She turned a law office. She took the same space that a home office used to be in, and she turned it into like a kitchen just for fun, for funsies. Just playing around, funsies.
Oh, that was just easy stuff. You wait till I get my hands on a real house.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, I go to the gym and work out for fun on my free time.
She, you know, just goes
design stuff.
I just want to design a house.
Well, it's like when you go out and take pictures of stuff just because.
But you would be proud of me, though.
It's fresh.
And you would be proud of me because I was on vacation. I had like a work vacation-y type thing, and so. A lot of it was vacation, though. And most of it was vacation. It was a universal trip that we were telling you about. And I did not bring a single camera.
That's odd.
Isn't it? And then my phone died, and I didn't even care. And I still had like 6 hours in the day. Yeah.
You got to get away, though. I mean, like, I love acting. I love writing. I mean, I was up till 3 in the morning literally writing last night. Well, to be honest with you, the last hour was spent writing and listening to the State of the Union address. Try doing that. I've got music playing in one ear, the State of the Union playing in this ear, and I'm writing.
I don't know how that's just confusing me, just thinking about it. How do you do like that?
It's, you know, I think for me, it's just like I find my most creative work happens when I'm stuck behind a desk working a meaningless, thankless day job, and my brain starts to go because it wants to escape. It's like, please give me something creative to do. I'm stuck behind 3 cubicle walls. Well, 2.5. I'd look at this person's forehead all day. When I used to work at my day jobs, I would be sitting there working, and I'd just have an email document up, just writing. And the moon crest over the clouds and climbed to its zenith, beaming down upon our hero as he makes his way through the muddy, swampy marsh. The oozing wet mud dripped down his forehead as he fell in something.
And that's why I can't come into work today.
Because I'm tired.
I bet you had the most creative emails. Like, if the state goes back and pulls your emails from when you worked for them.
Because I would get stuck in the middle of, like, conversing with people. Like, oh, I'm sorry, what was that? What was that about an ogre? Oh, sorry. Please, tell me about your account.
Oh, man, good stuff. Well, I think that's it for this week, right?
Yeah,
that's pretty, pretty packed show, no script. Next week, we'll have a lot of more to talk about, and we have another guest coming in, so it'll be pretty fun.
Guests.
Yeah.
But, yeah, anyway, guys, go to thetalkaroundtownshow.com and email us if you have any suggestions for what you want us to talk about, or go like us on Facebook. We always appreciate Facebook likes.
Yeah.
And, guys, thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you next week.